Grace and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ.
Amen.
How would you recognize Jesus if he came today? How would you know what he looked like? What would he represent? And how would we honor that and see it? Today, in hindsight, as Christians, we hear the story of Palm Sunday and we recognize who our Lord and King is. But let me set the conditions of the time period. Here's a time when the Jewish people are under oppression. We have a time when the Romans rule over all of the known world. And forever, the Jews have been waiting for someone to save them, to free them from oppression, to free them from the power of that which is over them. In this case, they see it as the Romans. But how do we recognize them? The people who we hear today, who are proclaiming Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. All of these words have come before. These are not words that naturally appear to them. They've learned this. They have come to hear these words from the lessons in Scripture, from the words of the prophets, and I pray from those who are in authority in their religious institutions, that they've been taught to see, to understand what it means to have love, be loved by a God who made them and comes to free them. How do we recognize, though, this one who's to come? We hear in Zechariah the words of the prophet. Rejoice gladly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now, the folks of that time period would know the prophetic voice, would hear this and have known the words of Zechariah. So, if 1 and 1 equals 2, and you see this one who's coming into town, you would go, hey, wait a minute, I know this story. And you would follow him. But there's even more so. For the last 3 years, the people have been following this miracle worker, this Jesus, this one who comes from Nazareth, and we know that nothing good can come from Nazareth. But how is it that these miraculous things have happened? The blind see, the lame dance, the hungry are filled. So miraculous things have happened. And we heard, as the one who was blind was healed. No sinner can do these things. So we know that this man is of God. We know that something righteous is happening here. We know that something special is embodied in this man. But wait, there's something strange happening here. We're proclaiming him king. So shouldn't he be riding on Micah's steed? Shouldn't he be victorious? Because we want to overthrow the Romans. They're the ones who are oppressing us. They're the ones who are subjugating us. They're the ones who are killing us. But he comes humbly, riding in on a donkey. The colt, the foal of donkey. Some of them, this is not the king we're waiting for. But those who know the prophet's voice will hear this. And the promise is this: he will cut off the chariot from Ephraim, and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. So this is not a king who comes to wage war in the conventional sense, but he does come to bring peace, and not just peace, peace to all the nations. So when we talk about the Prince of Peace, this is the one we've been waiting for. But do we recognize him? Do we see him? Is he the one we're looking for? Is he the one we've been waiting for? His dominion shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth, meaning that he will reign peace over everything, over every part of the known world. And this is, yes, is this not what the Jews have been waiting for? They're waiting for someone to free them and to bring peace. But the peace that we understand in the words of Zechariah are not peace as in the lack of warfare. It is about a wholeness with God. It is shalom. It is that moment of being connected, reconciled, made one with God. So they see in this, could you see in this man, this one who's riding on a donkey, that he comes to bring peace and reconciliation to the world? Is he God's messenger? Is he David's only son, the one who the prophets have proclaimed? Is he the one? Do you recognize him? As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. This is the sacrifice. He's the one who comes to atone. This is the covenant that God made with his people. He has made with his people, and we have forsaken. God has not forsaken, we have. So what does God do? He offers up this one, his only son, who we today proclaim as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Prince of Peace. He is the one whom we've been waiting for. Well, what does this kingdom mean? What does it mean to us? Is it that violence and warfare will come over the Romans? No. God, in his infinite wisdom, comes to bring peace to us by conquering our sin, by conquering our death, by conquering the devil. For these last 3 years, the disciples have been following behind, chasing after him, seeing him as he healed, as he fed, as he brought wholeness to God's people. So what will his reign look like? What does this king represent? What will his kingdom look like? Is it about peace without warfare? Unfortunately not. But it is that reconciling presence of God in our midst. It is that understanding that God will never leave us alone, that we are his, and he invites us into the celebration of reconciliation with him. And in this is shalom, is peace, is that moment of being one with God, now and forever. Amen. Yeah, you can't help it, can you? But what I love is the prophetic voice has already taught, has already shown, has already proclaimed what this king will look like. Who shall we look for? Who? How will we recognize him? He comes riding humbly. He is not a king on a mighty steed with armor and a sword and a shield, but he comes humbly, lovingly, to bring peace to all the world. This is what we talk about at Christmas. This is what we saw in the face of a small child. This is the king for whom we have been waiting. He comes humbly as a human being to take on our nature, our sorrow, our hurt, our joy, our rejoicing as his own. And we are made one in him. This is the king whom we have been waiting. We know that on Good Friday, the atoning sacrifice is given. And the blood of the new and everlasting covenant is shed for us. He descends into hell to free the prisoners. I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. So what does this all mean? What is this all supposed to do for us? Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. You heard me use the phrase prisoner of hope. You heard me use that last week before. It is about that we give our lives to one whom we entrust with our life, abundant life and eternal life, and that is Christ Jesus, our King. Now, it is a foreign language, as I said to the kids. We don't have a king. We do not kneel to anyone. We do not surrender to anyone. So this is all foreign language to us. But even in Philippians, you hear, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend. God comes down and conquers. He stoops to conquer so that we might be lifted up. And all that is asked of us is to honor that. And how do we honor that? We come full circle. We recognize the one whom God has sent to save us from sin, death, and the devil. We recognize that this is the one whom the prophets have proclaimed. Yet when the prophets came, we stoned them. Because we wanted a different kind of king. We wanted a different kind of war. But God, in his infinite wisdom, didn't listen to us, but knew what we needed, and sends one who frees us from sin by his atoning sacrifice, from death in his resurrection, and everlasting life in the gift of his Holy Spirit. So on this day, you are invited. We processed in here. Did it mean anything to you? Or is it something that we just do because it's part of our tradition? It was really weird to gather in the fellowship hall and not in here. For those of you who are here, we're glad that you kept the pews warm. But to me, I want you to see this differently. I want you to see it in the image that the prophets proclaimed. That this is one whom we come to worship, one whom we come to adore, but even more so that God sends because he adores us. He sends his son humbly into the world, first as a small child, through the humbleness of Mary, the humility of one who then sings, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior," as she is told, and she accepts the invitation to be the vessel through which the world is saved. He is a king that we did not expect. But the world needs. It's a king that we may not recognize because we're looking in a different direction. But the prophets keep coming and coming and coming to tell us what this king will look like so we might recognize him. And here he is. Now, why is he coming? And this is the story of Holy Week. But I'm going to invite you to come on Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, and the Vigil of Easter, but even more so, to have heard the stories all through Lent and all through your life, so that you might see what this truly means, that peace is ours, peace in our heart, peace in our minds, peace in our spirits. Because God so loves us that he gives us his Son. How will you recognize it? Even more so, how will you let it into your heart? How will you proclaim Hosanna? Blessed is he, blessed is she, blessed are all who come in the name of the Lord. The Lord comes to us first and foremost. He pays it forward. He gives his life. He gives us love and grace and mercy and healing. He takes on our nature so that though we might look for a different kind of king, he sends the king we need, not the one. He comes to bring peace to all creation. He brings and is an atoning sacrifice, and the blood of this covenant will set the prisoners free from the waterless pit. That place where we thirst for righteousness, thirst for healing, thirst for being connected to God and one another, but has been broken by sin. And we bind ourselves as he binds himself and is bound to the cross, that we might be bound as prisoners of hope. Because even in the midst of our struggles, in the midst of all that we live and we do, suffering brings character. Character brings endurance. No. Suffering brings endurance. Endurance brings character. Character brings hope. And hope never disappoints. Pastor might, hey. But it is. I want you to see Jesus, your King, again for the first time. That this King, we might have an image of what a King might look like, but the prophets have told us how we will recognize him. But even more so, what he brings. Peace, wholeness, salvation. This is what we celebrate. This is why we walk in here. The why is that God loves us. God calls us, but even more so, God gives us grace upon grace, healing in our sorrow and our suffering, and beauty through the gift of his Son. This is the King we may not have been looking for. This is the King we need. And in our baptism, we recognize that we are one in him, in his reign, as we bend at his knee bend our knees in his name and proclaim the Lord in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.